underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, no rings truer than this. So got children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, so got children. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. Darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. So God's children sing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. So God's children sing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. So God's children sing.
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna. just think of the song, the word that Bill Johnson said, everyone wants a king like Jesus. He's the desire of the nation. And as we just start going back into this chorus, I just want you to realize, like, every problem that you have is overshadowed by an even more powerful God. And I think the problem is we're so lost on our perspective of the small things that are coming at us that we lose sight of a God that's so good that can actually change every atmosphere. And he's trying to change your perspective because it's tied together. Your perspective of God leads to the breakthrough that you're looking for. So we're just gonna sing this. And I want you to just step into the goodness of God today. I don't care if you're sick. I don't care if you're facing financial difficulty. Guess what? He's a healer and he is a provider. There's nothing that is too impossible for God to break through in. He's the one that raises the dead. You can't get worse than that, right? So God, we're just gonna proclaim your goodness here. We're gonna invite you as our King. And you are good.
Your presence.
sir, and you came to my rescue, and I wanna be where you are. And I called and you answered, and you came to my rescue, and I wanna be where be where you are. rescue, and I wanna be where you
in your life, wherever you are right now. Before we come to the table, just to give Jesus his place as your King in your life right now. How can Jesus be lifted high? And so first, I want you just to surrender to the Lord everything that you would struggle with, holding nothing back, every temptation, every failure, just lay it before the Lord right now. Just confess it to Jesus. Right? No, it's just you and Jesus at this moment, okay? So there's no needing to impress anybody because the Lord already knows. He sees you. He sees it all. So let's just take a moment of confession between you and the Lord. Would you confess to the Lord? Where are your struggles? Where are your failures? Where are your difficulties? The Lord already knows, and he loves you in spite of it. He's going to accept you in spite of it. But it's just for you to confess it to him. Just be open to him.
Come to the table this
His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
by his blood, turns our failures into victories. He turns our shame into acceptance. He turns our sorrow into joy. He is glorified and he is lifted up in our midst. In our weaknesses, he is strong. And so as we take communion this morning, we are letting him transform us. We're receiving the blessing of the Lord into our lives. And so hold the bread in your hand right now. You're holding the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Lord, for the body. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so, Lord, we bring to you all of our weaknesses. We bring to you all of our failures. We bring to you our troubles and our sorrows. We bring to you all of the sickness. Lord, there is so much sickness that has been surrounding us lately in our communities. And even in this church, so many are sick today at home. And we thank you that by your stripes we are healed. We give you even our sicknesses, Lord. We give you our mental weaknesses, our emotional weaknesses, our spiritual weaknesses, Lord. And we ask you to turn them into strength, Father. Turn it around by the name of Jesus. We receive this now. Remember the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's take this together. Let the Lord redeem it. He says, blessed.
generation and your family and their children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and beside you and behind you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
I know some of you hate this when I do this, but I think it's important. I want you to gather in groups of three and four. No more than four, please. No less than three. And just pray blessing on your group real quick. Just hands on each other. Lay hands on one another and just pray blessing. Just pray the favor of the Father over you. If this freaks you out, you can recover later. It's okay. You'll be all right. Look around, make sure no one's alone, make sure no one's by themselves, invite them in. If they say, no, I'd rather not, then that's fine, you don't ever have to do anything. But would you make sure no one's left alone? Make sure no one's left out. Look around and make sure no one's left out. And just invite them in, and make sure you pray over them. Just pray blessing, the Father's favor. It comes through the blood of Jesus. Stuff. God's favor go before you. Amen. Hey, we want to just remind you to honor the Lord with your giving this morning. And if you want to get up right now in the back of the room, we have boxes on the sides of the doorways there. There's two, looks like mailboxes back there. And you're welcome to go back and give and put your offering. You can go right now and put your offering back there. You could do it when you leave. You could do it as you're coming. You're coming and you're going. you can be blessed as you give to the Lord. You can also text to give. I think we have a slide up there that we can put up there for you to tell you how to do that. And as you're giving too, there's several of you who have given online in the past, and you've given through the Breeze app. And so we are switching over from Breeze to Church Planning Center. And so that's that, that is that QR code that keeps coming up when we do our announcements. And there's a little QR code that shows up there so that you can download the Planning Center on your phone, and you can give through the Planning Center now, because we're going to be shutting down the Breeze and we're moving over to the Planning Center. So if you've been giving online through Breeze, just double check that and just transfer everything over to Planning Center if you could. I know there's several people who have been giving that way through Breeze, and we're no longer going to be doing that. So just need to be getting you to transfer over. If you need help doing that, let us know. And we'll be glad to help you out with that if that's complicated for you and you haven't yet figured it out and figured out Planning Center as well. Again, Planning Center, get it on your phone. You can get all the information you need. It acts as your bulletin. It is your lifeline. It is your connection. It is your information. You can get a hold of one another through that as well. If we have to ever cancel church for any reason, we're going to tell you through that app. So it's really an important app to get on your phone. And if you guys have signed up, any men signed up for the men's retreat? How many of you guys in here are going to the men's retreat? Anybody?
Yeah.
Me? So good. All right. So I know a lot of people are sick today. This is like not many people here this morning. That's okay. So many sick people, we need to be praying for that. But if you're going to the men's retreat, here's the deal. We need the money, okay? So it's $50, and you can still sign up. We have sign-up sheets in the foyer, but if you've signed up, we need the money, okay? So we need you to get the $50 to us within the next couple weeks, because they're going to need to shop for the food and get everything ready for it. And so we're going to need that money, okay? So it's one thing to sign up. Now you got to step up and actually pay for it, okay? That's the fun part. So $50, so if you could do that, that would be really incredible. And this week, want to let you know, this week is Holy Week. So what we're doing here is every evening, Monday through Friday, we're gathering for prayer and for worship and waiting on the Lord. And we want to invite you to join us. So basically, it's an open house. It's kind of an open house forum. So from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. all week long, every night this week, 4 to 6, you can drop in. You can come for the whole time if you want. So it's 2-hour slots. If you want to just, maybe there's one of the nights you want to come and just, that's the night you want to seek the Lord. Come for the whole 2 hours. You can come for the whole 2 hours every night if you want to. But if you're like, hey, I have about a half an hour that I can come before dinner. Awesome. Come, drop in for a half an hour. Come as you can, leave as you must. For 2 hours, anytime between 4 and 6, just drop in. We're going to be having worship, praying, seeking the Lord, and just believing for God to really, really bless you in all of that, okay? So participate as much as you can. All right. Well, today is Palm Sunday. And already, like, happens fast. And Palm Sunday's a really cool day. And one of my favorite days of the year is Palm Sunday. It's a day that we really rejoice at Jesus. We recognize Jesus as our coming King. If we're going to turn to Mark chapter 11, I want to talk to you this morning a little bit about Palm Sunday in perspective of what were the disciples dealing with on Palm Sunday. Okay, so if we can go to Mark chapter 11, starting in verse 7, and this is a story. And they brought the colt to Jesus, and they threw a cloak on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Verse 10, blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. And he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So here's what's going on here. Jesus, the streets are crowded. They're packed with people shouting. Basically the whole city of Jerusalem is stirred up because they are ready to crown Jesus as king. Their imagination, their mind is for the Jewish people is that when the Messiah comes, all the prophecies about Messiah coming, they saw him as a very literal physical kingdom and a physical king, kind of like David, and coming like as David, King David, and he's going to come and he's going to throw out the Roman oppression. He's going to overcome all of their oppressors. He's going to reestablish Israel as an independent nation again under the kingdom of God. And this is all going to be ushered in. This was their hope. This is what they signed up for. This is what the disciples signed up for. This is why they're following Jesus. They're expecting this dynamic, incredible leader to come and start this armed rebellion against the Roman oppressors. And so they're very excited about it. Everything in this passage speaks of this messianic prophecies about the king coming on a colt, the donkey, on this donkey. And so that's why they're shouting, Hosanna. Hosanna means save us now. Now's the time, Jesus. Save us now. And so they're expecting this is their day of liberation. They're ready and they're excited. And Jesus comes as triumphant entry, pomp, and circumstance. I mean, they're throwing things on the ground before him, like kind of like throw out the red carpet, as we would say in our day and age. They're waving their palm branches, and they're hailing him to be the king. Not Caesar, Jesus. Just the very act of them saying this, by the way, is an insurrection. It's rebellion. You cannot proclaim someone to be king when Caesar is king. And so they're in defiance to Rome and defiance to Caesar himself. Jesus is king. Amen. This is his kingdom. This is what they're ready for. And they're ushering all this in. So Jesus comes in and this is happening. And he comes, the Bible says he comes to Jerusalem and he looks around at the temple and he leaves. He leaves. Goes away. Imagine the disciples. Imagine what they were thinking. Like, wait a minute. Like, you know, this thing is going on and this is starting. They're like, hey, this is it. This is what we've waited for. This is the king who's coming. This is what we signed up for. Yeah, Jesus. Jesus is going to take his throne, and we're going to be right next to him with our little thrones, you know? Like, this is the moment that we've been waiting for. This is it. This is what we've been working for. It's arrived. We've arrived, right? And just as Jesus enters the temple, just as the disciples are ready to crown him king, they're ready to start it. Jesus, you know, and in their minds, they're imagining Jesus is going to get up and say, okay, rise up, and here's power to defeat the Romans. I mean, look what Jesus could do. Look at the miracles he can do. Surely he can, like, blot out the sun. What is he going to do? Call down fire from heaven? What's he going to do? Like, he's the king. He's Messiah. He could do anything. What's going to happen? And he comes in, and Mark tells us Jesus turns around and walks out. Can you imagine how disappointed they were? How let down they were? Like, this is like such a letdown that nothing happens. Can you relate? Have you ever been disappointed by Jesus? Have you ever been disappointed by God? Now, put aside your religion for a minute. Put aside the right answer. Put aside what you're supposed to say. I know we're not supposed to say, I was really disappointed by Jesus. I was disappointed by God. We're not supposed to say those things, right? That's not supposed to happen. And so it's even worse when we've been there and we're suddenly disappointed, and the guilt and the shame you feel because you're not supposed to feel this way. The guilt and shame you feel when you thought you were going to be pregnant and you're not, and you're disappointed. The guilt and shame you feel when you thought God was going to do it like this and he didn't. The guilt and shame you feel when you thought God was going to do this with your children and that's not how it worked out at all. You thought your marriage would be like this. You thought your home would be like this. You thought your ministry was going to look like this and it didn't turn out that way, and you're so disappointed, but you're not supposed to be disappointed, and now you feel guilt and shame. Because you're not supposed to feel that way, right? You're not supposed to be disappointed with God. And I'm telling you right now, I've been disappointed many, many, many times with God. He didn't do quite what I wanted him to do. And if you haven't been there yet, you haven't served Jesus very long, or you haven't served him at all, because it's coming. It's coming. You will feel the sting of disappointment. When your marriage didn't turn out the way you thought, the career isn't quite what you thought it would be. Not many of you would have, not many of you would want to admit that, maybe. But the reality is, there's disappointment that happens. Have you ever been disappointed in how things turned out? Jesus calls you to something. Maybe he calls you to a ministry. He calls you to a church. And things did not turn out the way you thought that you planned it to turn it out to be, and it's something different. And if you can think of something disappointing like that, if you can think of something that didn't turn out like you thought it would when God called you to it, then you have a little bit of an idea what these disciples must have been feeling at that moment. The oh moment. Right? This is not what I signed up for. Wait a minute. You want me to jump where? You want me to do what? You want, huh? Disappointment. This wasn't it. This wasn't going as planned. And soon it was going to get even worse. Who knew that in only a week's time, this same crowd's going to show up again on Friday, and they're not going to be celebrating. They're not going to be saying, Hosanna. They're going to be shouting what? Crucify him. Who knew that? Plot twist. Who saw that coming? Who saw that coming? Come on. Have you ever been disappointed? You didn't see that coming. You got sideswiped. You thought you could trust this person and you cannot trust them. Boom, plot twist, I didn't see that coming. You thought this was going this way and boom, everything changed and it turned into a nightmare for you right now. Plot twist, disappointing. Remember when Jesus called you? Remember when you gave your life to the Lord? Remember when you said yes to his call and yes to his ministry? Remember when you said yes to that marriage and yes to that situation and yes to that career path? It's easier to have faith when Jesus acts and says and does things that you agree with. It's easier to have faith and follow him when it does it your way, right? When things work out your way. If he's gonna be a bless me savior, if he's only gonna do what I'm comfortable with, he's only gonna move in ways that suits me, then I'm ready to give my yes. Remember Peter, Lord, I will never leave you. Everybody else will fail you, but I never will. It's easy to do that in the moment, isn't it? But just like these disciples, there's going to be times in our faith walk that our faith is going to be tested. That your faith is going to be tested. That life is not going to work out the way you imagine and you plan. Where we feel like partying one minute and wondering what in the heck we're doing the next minute. This crowd's showing up. Why is this party crowd there? This party crowd on Palm Sunday. They're there partying in the streets, but they're going to reject his plan on Good Friday. How does that happen? Here's how it happens, because often we accept God's plan when it suits us, but we reject it when it doesn't suit us. We accept it when we think it's going to be glorious and easy, but we reject it when it gets difficult. Very often, we can be very fickle. What about, you know, Jesus as a religious figure is great. Jesus as the, you know, behold the lilies of the field. That's great. That's sweet. That's nice. The religious figure, the religious Jesus that shows up and the Christianity where I do it on Sunday morning for an hour, only an hour, don't go over. I do it on Sunday morning for an hour, or I do it once a month, or maybe I'm a Christer, I come for Christmas and Easter. That's okay. Show up occasionally to a church service, that's fine. But what about the difficult things? What about die to myself? Amen. What about follow me? What about obedience to his word? What about letting Jesus transform me? That's a lot harder, isn't it? That's a lot more difficult to say yes to. We're okay with the party, but surrendering to God's plan for my life? Wait a minute. Are we really okay with, are we really okay with one thing is necessary? Are we really okay with that? Are we really okay with it's all about Jesus? Are we really okay with encountering God? Because it means encountering God means I'm going to be confronting my sin and I'm going to be confronting my brokenness, because that's exactly what encountering God is going to bring to you. Because God is a consuming fire. And when we encounter his presence, we're going to encounter the consuming hot burning fire of his presence. It's going to want to burn up my sin and my rebellion. He's going to want to expose all that stuff in me that I don't want to see. I want it to be her fault. I don't want it to be my fault. I don't want it to be me. I want God to come and move on you. Like these stories of revival where everyone's running to the altar and repenting, that's beautiful, but I don't want to be the one up at the altar repenting. Like, I don't want to be the one having issues. But I do have them. Amen. So this is a different level. So now maybe you could begin to understand what the disciples are being confronted with on Palm Sunday. They're okay with the whoop, 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 Hosanna, whoop, 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 whoop. Let's get going, Jesus. Yeah, Jesus on the throne. Wooka wooka. If my kids were in the front of that, they'd say, don't do that again. Don't do that. My daughter's in the back saying, don't do that. She's going like this to me. Don't do that, Dad. That's embarrassing. Okay. Three shocking things that are difficult things, or difficult truths about following Jesus that we have to embrace, that these disciples were confronted with in that moment. There'll be moments of your life you're going to be confronted head on with these truths. Number one, following Jesus isn't safe. It's not safe. At least it won't feel safe. It won't seem safe. Everything in you is going to say, this isn't safe. If it's really the Lord, everything inside you is going to be going, ah! Because if it's safe and you can do it in your own power, in your own strength, it's probably not even the Lord. It's going to take faith, right? Yes. So these disciples, they saw all the miracles. They saw the power of the Lord. They saw Jesus do mighty, mighty things. And they're looking for this mighty king who's going to come, right, kick out the Romans, conquer the world, establish his earthly kingdom. Jerusalem is the capital. And they're his, like, little ambassador kind of guys, whatever, his council, his inner circle, they're his round table. But instead of a conquering king coming on this white stallion, they look up and, first of all, here's Jesus not coming on a white stallion to conquer. He's sitting on a donkey, right? He's coming like Jesus on a donkey, right? That's not the picture of this conquering king that I would have expected. That's a little disappointing. That's a little, you know, that's not quite what I would imagine. He's coming riding on a donkey. And instead of throwing out the Romans, Jesus goes into the temple. He looks around and he leaves suddenly. And instead of a throne, Jesus takes up a cross. Amen. They'd given everything for their plan. They'd given their life to Jesus for the plan that they were expecting. And this was not safe. This humble Jesus, this isn't good. We've stirred up an insurrection here, guys. We've just stirred up Jerusalem to rebel against Caesar. They're all yelling that Jesus is king and he's gonna leave. This is not good. This is not safe. Bad idea. And many, many in the church world today, they're looking at the plan of God and listen, they hold back. Because it doesn't look safe. Or they're doubting that this could be God because, you know, God's plan is always safe, isn't it? He's always safe. He always does what I need him to do. He always makes me comfortable, doesn't he? So now I'm not feeling comfortable. This must not be God. And so we walk away from God. We talk about a move of God. Think about this. We say this, we want God to move in Pulaski. We want God to move in this region. We want to see a move of God at New Life Church. Is this going to be safe? I want to know. Is this going to be safe? Can I just tell you something? We have to decide if we're going to be a church that's going to be safe, or are we going to be a church that's going to go after the presence of God? What kind of church are we going to be? Do we want to be the safe church, or do we want to be the Jesus church? Are we going to be the safe church, or do we want to be the manifest, transformational presence of God that transforms and brings the hot, fiery presence of the Lord into this house? The one that's going to surely confront us, the one who's going to challenge us, the one that's going to he's going to convict us, he's going to conflict us, he's going to bring the sword and not peace, but a sword. That's what he says he's going to do. He's going to put father against mother and mother against father and kids against parents, and he's just cleaning house. Do we understand that when God moves, he's a consuming fire? Yes. And he does all these kind of crazy things. He burns up all of our idols and that all the things that I hold so dear and I hold so precious, my way and my culture and my things that are sacred, in his holy consuming fire, they get burned up and I have to surrender them to his presence. Because when he moves, our idols are not going to be safe. When he moves, my ways are not going to be safe. When he moves, our treasures will not be safe. Our very self will not be safe. Our ways, what I like, what I feel, what I'm comfortable with, they will not be safe. So people steer clear because they don't look and they don't feel safe the ways of God. And so many Christians in the world today, they're including what we would call traditional, quote unquote, Pentecostal or charismatic churches out there, they're steering clear of the things of God because God isn't safe. Holy Spirit isn't safe in their eyes. Speaking in tongues, not safe, it'll scare the visitors. In reality, it only scares religious carnal Christians. But in our minds, our justification is we want to reach the lost. And so we want to reach the lost, so we can't let Jesus out. Because our programs will save the lost. Our little show we're putting on will save the lost. The coffee we serve will save the lost. The atmosphere will save the lost. The lights will save the lost. Whatever, you know, three songs and the short sermon, that's what will save the lost. But Jesus and the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, dangerous. It'll scare the visitors. So don't let him out. He's crazy. Don't let him out. He's not safe. We're not safe with these things. C.S. Lewis's novel, Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe. There's that line in there that I love so much. There's the character Lucy, and she asks about Aslan. And you know, in the story, Aslan is kind of a representation of Jesus. He represents Jesus. And Lucy says, is Aslan this lion, right? He's a roaring lion. And she's a little nervous, and she says, is he quite safe? And they say, of course he's not safe. Of course he's not safe. But he's very good. He's not safe, but he is very good. Jesus isn't safe, but Jesus is very good. Matthew 16, verse 24. Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. This won't fill seats. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So Jesus waved, take up your cross and follow me. Lose your life. These are not safe statements. The cross does not seem, and the cross will never feel safe. Surrendering your life and laying your life down will never feel, and it will never seem like a safe thing to do. Anybody ever died in here? Physically die? Who wants to? It's called mental illness if you do, and you need help immediately. Like, you need help if you want to die. No one wants to die. Why? Because it's really scary and it doesn't feel safe. That's not a safe thing to do. We try really hard to never die. It's my life goal and ambition to not go to my funeral. I'm going to skip that one. Thank you very much. But Jesus rises up and says, no, actually, you got to lay your life down. You got to die to yourself. You got to die to all this stuff. That's just not safe. Many times we miss the blessing of God, and we miss the move of God. We miss the healings of God. We miss miracles of God. We miss mighty things of God because they just don't seem safe to us. There's a reason Jesus literally chased off crowds of people. He had hordes of people following him. He literally chased them off. He whittled it down to 12. And even those 12 were like, not sure. Jesus says to the 12, are you leaving too? And they're like, Well, where else are we going to go? You're the only one who has the words of life. What are we going to do? I guess we better stay. Which isn't a great thing. Like, if you said to your wife, like, do you want, you know, on our anniversary, we just celebrate our 29th anniversary. And I said to my wife, do you want another 29 years? And she said, absolutely. But if she would have gone, well, you know, where else could I go for a house? At this point, it's going to cost a lot more money to get rid of you than to keep you. And there's frowned upon murder. That's not going to work either. So I guess, you know, yeah, sure. You know, that's not what you want to hear. You want to hear like, absolutely, yes, I'm in. Woo! Jesus, by modern church standards, you realize, is a total failure. Total failure. Because everywhere you go, how many people are in your church? How many of you guys get asked that? If you say, I go to New Life Church, well, how many people are there? One of the first questions everybody asks, how many seats do you fill? If Jesus is worried about offending people, Palm Sunday would have never, ever, ever happened. And that the disciples had to learn, but we have to learn. His plan will not look as you thought. And that will scare the tar out of you. It did them. It did these disciples were terrified about this. You and I have to learn what the disciples had to learn that day. Jesus never promises you safe. Jesus never promises you comfortable. He never promises you these things. Following Jesus is not going to seem safe, but listen to me, it's going to be good. Because he's not safe, but he is very, very good. Because he is so good, and he is so kind, and it's going to be worth it. So number one, Jesus, following Jesus is not safe. So put that out of your mind. Just say, hey, this isn't going to be safe. Number two, following Jesus is very costly. It's going to be very costly. Now, in reality, the safest place to be is in the hands of God, in the will of the Lord. It actually is safe, but I'll say it will feel not safe to you. If you're going to judge it by how you feel, you're not going to follow Jesus. It's going to freak you out. But it's actually going to be really good. And then following Jesus, it's going to be very, very costly. It'll seem very costly to you. For some people, the cost is going to just be too great. I mean, how easy would it have been for those disciples just to like follow along right in their plan? Like, yeah, Jesus, come on. And Jesus calls down fire from heaven and they just go and they sit on their little mini thrones next to the big throne of Jesus, right? Like, Jesus, this is it. I mean, come on. You know, Jesus, you remember your throne? Like, whoop, you know, and then remember. Don't forget me. That would have been easy. But that wasn't their experience. That wasn't the plan the Father had. Jesus prayed in the garden. You're familiar with this. Matthew 26, 39. Going a little further, he fell on his face. He prayed saying, Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Even to Jesus, the plan of God did not seem like a safe plan. I don't want to do this. If this is possible, let this pass from me. If it's possible, Lord, I don't want to go through that. If it's possible, let this be easy. But yet, not my will be done, but your will be done. Amen. See, Palm Sunday reminds us that the plans of God never bypasses the cross. You can't get to victory apart from the cross. It's costly. Following Jesus is going to be costly. One thing is necessary, will cost you. It'll cost you your time. It'll cost you your commitment. It'll cost your reputation and the judgment that you're going to get from religious Marys and Marthas, or the Marthas all around you. Yes, You're going to be judged and you're going to be ridiculed by them. It's going to cost you. It might cost you pouring out on Jesus that which is costly. It might cost you surrendering your very self to him and surrendering your idols and everything you hold dear and precious and sacred and pouring it at his feet. It may even cost you your pride and your dignity. There's always a price to pay. Revival never comes without a price. Someone has to pay it. Glory never comes without a price. Blessings never come without a price. It's costly. The price is going to be the cross. We die to ourselves. We die so he lives. Less of me and more of him. We die to our will that his will can be done. We die to our desires that we may obey his desires and his heart.
Thank you, Jesus.
For the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. There's a guy named Bill Wilson. Started a sidewalk Sunday school in New York. Thousands and thousands of children. Here's what he says. He said, the impact you will have on the world is in the direct proportion to the sacrifice that you're willing to make. I think that's Jesus. I think that's biblical. I think that's what Jesus would say. It sounds like gospel to me. Direct proportion. What's the impact that you want to make? What kind of a mark do you want to leave on the earth? It's going to be in direct proportion to the sacrifice that you're willing to make. But we see the price tag, and many are not going to pay the price. And the crowds decided this is too costly. Crucify him. Throw him out. So we miss out on the impact. We miss out on the blessing. We miss out on revival. We miss out on healing or whatever it is that we're going after. We miss out on those things because we're not willing to pay the price. We miss out on the restored marriage and the healing of the relationships. And we decide that it's just too difficult and the price was just too high. We discover that miracles are not cheap. Whether they're physical or whether a miracle in your marriage or relationships or a miracle in your finances, whatever it is you're looking for. Someone asked Catherine Coleman, and I don't know if most of you are familiar with Catherine Coleman, but the room is getting younger every week, I'm telling you. I think you're all getting younger because I'm not getting older, so y'all must be getting younger. I don't know what's happening here, but so a lot of you maybe don't know now who Catherine Coleman was, but she was a powerful woman of God that was really strange and unusual, and she was bizarre, actually, I would say, in my perspective. She wore these long white, like flowing wings on her arms, and she would come out on the stage and she'd say, "Have you been waiting for me? I believe in miracles." And she was weird. And you today would watch her and go, like, if I came out here like that, you know, "Hello, I believe in miracles."
We love you,
Eric. I mean, you'd be like, what in the world? But here's the deal. Miracles happened.
Yes.
Powerful things happened.
Yes.
People's lives were changed and transformed. Like supernatural, powerful things happened. People out of wheelchairs, people who couldn't walk, paraplegics began to walk. Blind could see, the deaf could hear in the name of Jesus. And she preached Jesus crucified, Jesus coming again, Jesus' power and presence and miracles. And it was powerful. Like she could fill stadiums and crazy. Like Benny Hinn, compared to her. Like she was even like levels above. Like it was incredible what the woman would experience and what people would experience in her presence. But anyways, people would watch that. They would see this. They would see the crowds, right? They would see the miracles. And they, oh, wouldn't that be great to do that? Wouldn't that be great to have that? I want that. So they began to ask her, how do I get that? How do I get these results? How do I do what you're doing? What does that take? And Catherine Coleman, she would say, it will cost you everything. It'll cost you everything. See, no one saw the price she paid to get there. You only see the results. No one saw the price it took to get there. And very few are willing to pay the price. Why aren't there more miracles? Why don't we see God do more things? Why don't we see mighty revival and moves of God? And why aren't these things happening? And I wonder if it's because someone has to pay the cost. Someone has to pray. Someone has to fast. Someone has to sacrifice. Someone has to risk. And who's willing to do it? What kind of church are we going to be? Do we really want to encounter God? We really want to be a church that's all about Jesus at the center of everything? Do we really want to be a church where only one thing is necessary? You cannot bypass the cross. Or do we want to be popular? And do we want to fill the seats? And we want to be easy? What do we want? And don't get me wrong, you go after Jesus and you'll fill seats. You go after filling seats, you might fill the seats, but you won't get Jesus. And I don't care how many people are here. I'd rather have the glory of God here. I'd rather have the presence of God here. I'll take a worship team who has the anointing and the power of God on their life over everything else. Yes. That's what's valuable. That's the value of the kingdom of God. I'll take the anointing over all of it. You can't bypass the cross. Let me ask you this morning, are you willing? There's always a price to pay, but the price, listen to me, the price is worth it. The sacrifice is worth it. Here's the deal. Really, what we call sacrifice pales in comparison to what you get. It pales. This crummy little phony rotten idols that I want to hold on to pale in comparison. Think of the children of Israel. God Almighty, Yahweh, wants to be their God and he's going to be their people. But they're wanting to make a cow and worship it. Our idols are so less than what God wants to give us. But we're convinced in our mind that they're so precious and I got to hold on to them. What God wants to give me is so much grander and greater than my reputation and how my friends think about me and what the community thinks about me and what people online think about me. What the presence of God is so much greater than that. You can have it all. Are we willing? Do we realize this? Mark chapter 10, 29, Jesus said, truly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mothers or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive, listen, 100-fold now in this time. Houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecution. It's going to cost you. And in the age to come, eternal life. Will it cost me? Yes. Will there be persecution? Yes. Will it be difficult? Yes, at times. But listen, what I'm gaining is so much more than what I could ever give and what I could ever sacrifice and what I'm ever going to go through. And I get it. Life's hard. It's difficult. But what we gain is so much more. Sacrifice pales in comparison to the blessing and obedience of following Jesus. And this is the king I want to serve. The one who's humble, the one who's gentle, the one who doesn't come and enforce me. But he lets me choose. See, the world is such a daunting taskmaster. My idols are horrible taskmasters that I have to serve. Satan is a terrible taskmaster. My flesh is a terrible, just cynical taskmaster. Hard. But Jesus, his yoke is light. His burden is easy. And let me just tell you, as a Christian, if you're under a heavy weight, you're wearing the wrong yoke. Throw it off and get Jesus' yoke. Because Jesus is easy, easy, light, light, break it down, Charlie Brown. And if you're experiencing something different, it's not the right taskmaster. You're under a different yoke. We need to exchange those yokes. That's the sacrifice. We're throwing off these hard yokes of our taskmasters and our idols and our likes and our wants and our desires, and we get rid of them and we exchange it for his light load. That's a good exchange, but we don't realize it in the moment. In the moment, it feels like a horrible sacrifice. My reputation is on the line after all. My dignity is on the line after all. Number three, last one, Jesus. Following Jesus requires that you trust him. Because you will not do this unless you trust him. If you don't trust he has something better for you, if you don't trust that his way is better than your ways, if you don't trust that he is good and he's kind and he's gentle and he has some good plan for your life, you'll never do it. You'll cling to everything and you'll never give anything up. When Jesus says dying on the cross, he means like what he did. He died on the cross. You're taking up your cross and you're following him. But when Jesus is dying on the cross and he's hanging on the cross, his words on the cross kind of give us an insight of what, how could he go through that? How could he say, Father, not my will be done, but your will be done. If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. How did he get from there to dying on the cross? How did he do that? And we get a clue into the kind of relationship he had with the Father here. Luke chapter 23, verse 46. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Amen. And having said this, he breathed his last. Here's the contemporary English version. It says this, Jesus shouted, Father, I put myself in your hands. Then he died. The Message Bible says this, Jesus called loudly, Father, I place my life in your hands. Then he breathed his last. And then here's the New Living Translation. Then Jesus shouted, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And with those words, he breathed his last. Jesus could gladly endure the cross. He could gladly bear the cross. He can go through the cross. Listen, he understood that he could entrust himself into the hands of the Father. And he said, Lord, I surrender to you. I entrust myself to you. And he gave himself into the hands of the Father. He trusted the Father. Trusted him completely. And this is what the Lord's after. He wants our total surrender. Yes, he does. He wants our total heart. Yes, absolutely. But most of all, he wants our total trust. Have our worship team come up right now, if you would. He wants your total trust. Do you trust the plan of God for your life? And it'll probably not look like you think. It's probably not going to go the way you think it's going to go. That's true. but it will be in the long run. Amen. If your goal is to feel safe, then we're going to miss it. At the cost of his presence, you're going to miss it. If our goal as a church is to fill seats, we will miss the presence. But if our goal is his presence, then he draws all men to himself,
yes,
and he will build his church.
Amen.
And we get to choose.
Yes.
Do you trust your life into the hands of God?
Yes.
We said earlier, Jesus isn't safe, but he is good. He's faithful and he's true, and we can trust him.
Yes.
He actually is safe.
Yes.
He just doesn't feel like it in the moment. If you ask for an egg, he's not going to give you a serpent. So when you trust his character, then we're going to go ahead and ask. And we'll press in and we'll follow to the very end, regardless of the cost. Because we trust him. There's too many pilgrims who would follow Jesus on the road to the throne, but they would ditch him on the road to the cross. They would wave palms before the coming king, but they would not obey the suffering servant. How about you? Will you follow the suffering servant? It won't be safe. But it's going to be good. And it's going to cost you. And it's going to require that you trust the character of God. And you put your life in his hands. So I'm going to invite you to do a prophetic action today. And I'm not doing this to create drama or to manipulate anyone here. But sometimes we just need to express something and we need to do something to respond to the Lord. And I want to just create space for that and create an opportunity to respond to the message this morning and to the word of God this morning. So as an act of faith, I want to invite you to come to the altar today. I want you to come up here to this altar, and if you can, kneel. If you can't, that's okay too. Just stand and pray. But do this as a symbol and an act of faith. You're coming and saying, Lord, I'm not going to settle for less than the total plan of God for my life. I'm willing to follow you all the way to the cross, Lord. I'm committed to going all out for Jesus. So walk on up here, lay everything at the feet of Jesus. Maybe just find a place, just pray. Talk to the Lord about your commitment level. Talk to him about your eagerness to follow him. Maybe you need to rededicate your life to him. Rededicate yourself to him. Maybe you need to come and ask for more passion. Maybe you need to ask for more determination to be all in. Bring all those areas that you've been disappointed in. Bring all those places that you didn't turn out the way you thought they were going to turn out. Does he still have your yes? In the midst of it all, knowing what you know, knowing the disappointments you know, knowing how hard the path is now, does he still have your yes? So come this morning and rededicate and recommit your yes. Reconfirm it. Yes, Lord, you have me. Yes, Lord. You don't need to stay long if you don't want to. If you don't want to stay long, you want to slip out quickly, you go ahead. No one cares. No one's watching you. No one's looking around. Leave when you're ready, whether it's short or long or whatever time you. I just want to bridge it again. I'm just creating a space for you to respond. I feel like the Lord will do something in your life. I feel like there's people here that you're just, it's been difficult. It's been hard. And maybe you've questioned. question the kindness of God deep down in your heart, not up at the surface, not where anyone would hear you, but deep in your heart, there's been this questioning of God's plan for you and God's intentions for you. Is he really good? Is he really kind? Can I really trust him? What's he doing? I'm confused about this. This isn't the God I thought he was. This isn't what I thought it was going to be. And I believe in this moment, God wants to meet you and he wants to reconfirm in you that he is never going to leave you nor forsake you. That he looked at you with love and he looked at you with compassion. He knows what it is to suffer. He knows what it is to struggle. He is the one who said, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. I don't want to do this anymore. And I feel like there's some here that say, I can't do this anymore. I don't want this anymore. I can't handle this. And I believe when you come and say, but Lord, let your will be done. He wants to exchange. He wants to take your yoke. He wants to give you his light yoke. He wants you to cast your cares on him and cast your yoke on him. And he wants to exchange it. Hard path leads to glory. You're not alone. Give
feel you all around me. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Welcome to New Life. We're excited you're here. Here's what's coming up.
So that's what's happening. Follow us on social media for more.
Welcome to New Life. We're excited you're here.